Invitational. In our first game, three-time 1990 winner, colorful Chris Warren of Dallas, Texas, will take on Tulsa, Oklahoma's Mike Edwards, who's still looking for his first championship. That winner will face third-seeded Walter Ray Williams, Jr. of Stockton, California, who hopes to break a three-year winless drought. In the semifinal game, we'll see last week's winner, David Ozio of Vidor, Texas. And our tournament leader has a unique style and needs to win just one game for his first PBA title, Mike Miller of Albuquerque. That's our outstanding field for today's Professional Bowlers Tour telecast. They traveled in the old days.
Now let's take a look at the championship pair. There are very slick lanes this week. There's oil down to 6 feet, another coat down to 12 feet, another coat down to 18 feet, and a fourth coat down to 28 feet. Now all this oil is dragged down the lane to a 45-foot spot, so it's very slick, and then dry the last 15 feet. Now all the players but Walter Ray Williams Jr. will be playing the big hook ball. They'll be starting the ball around the second arrow, swinging out to the edge, and into the 1-3 pocket, Chris, and there's a lot of prize money at stake.
Out of the total of $175,000, $34,000 will go to the winner, 18-10, 7-6. Coming up next, ABC's Wide World of Sports begins its 30th anniversary year, as figure skaters Brian Boitano, Liz Manley, Roz Sumners will be competing in the NutraStreet World Challenge of Champions. Now, in addition, there have been some dramatic developments concerning the World Cup downhill skiing in Bengen, Switzerland. During qualifying yesterday, a young Austrian skier had a terrible fall, and this morning, tragically, died. Consequently, the event schedule for today has been suspended. Bob Beatty in Europe will have a full report. Wide World of Sports, following our Professional Bowlers Tour telecast. In our first match, we have Mike Edwards and Chris Warren. Mike from Tulsa and Chris Warren from Dallas, Texas. You saw Chris a lot last year. He had three victories, finishing second behind Amleta Monacelli in victories and the money department. Chris with $197,000 earned, plus a victory in the Japan Cup. You look good on that shot, Bo.
Well, Chris, the lane is 42 inches wide, and he used just about all of it on that shot as he swung it out to the channel. Now, you see a little bit different style from Mike Edwards, a little more conventional, down and in.
29-year-old. And there's so many people rooting for Mike Edwards to win his very first PBA championship. Very successful. But that first victory coming up, maybe.
Mike Edwards, basically a long approach, a six-step style. He's only a shoulder-high swing, a very strong individual. When he was playing football in his high school days, was bench-pressing over 300 pounds. Now has trimmed down to a spelt 185 to accommodate that nice, smooth bowling style. Going for a double, second frame.
Leaving a 10-pin on the left lane. Mike was on our telecast three times last year.
You see Mike, a normal shot right around the second arrow, just a medium hook, and he leaves a solid 10, six pin just flying around the 10. And Chris, a lot of solid 10s left by the players who don't hook the ball a lot. That's why you see players like our tournament leader, Miller, up there top.
A lot of speed, cross lane. Mike Edwards at Tulsa. Sigh of relief after getting that mark. He's going against Chris Warren, who never watches his opponent. He does sort of a 90-degree look away when his opponent's bowling, but watch him now, the man that lives dangerously on these lanes.
Around the world shot, looks like it's almost going in the channel, then breaks very sharply, almost leaves the 4-7-9 split. And Chris, as we see the style of Chris Warren, a five-step delivery, and he has a real high backswing, and he gets a good inside-out swing, tremendous wrist action, doesn't get very close to the foul line, about 6-8 inches behind the foul line. but the right-hand lane has been the trouble lane over the years on this championship pair.
All right. This is actually the 32nd PBA championship here, and over the years, Nelson, we've had just the great names. Dick Weber, Ski Ferenczky, Dave Davis, Billy Allen, all of them have won this event.
A lot of great champions, and we'll take a look at the position of Chris Warren on the lanes. He's going to get up on the approach and stand just a bit on the left side, and he's going to slide way over here on the left, and you watch the ball trajectory out between the second and third arrows and obviously precipitously close to the gutter.
Now it's a 7-pin, or almost a begging Chris Warren for that pin to fall, but solid as a rock.
Chris Warren with the big hook ball, and I don't blame him. Every time he hit around the 1-3 pocket with that much power, you expect to get a strike. That time he just sliced that 5-pin right in front of the 7. He has that 5 jumping.
Mike Edwards now will be up shooting in the third frame. Opened with a strike if you just joined us, and marked with a spare. This is our first game in the finals of the Showboat Invitational. $34,000 to the winner. Earlier we had a chance to ask each of the bowlers if they had a message for our troops in the Persian Gulf region.
Yeah, I'd just like to say, keep the faith, guys. Our thoughts and our prayers are with you and your families, and good luck and come home safe.
Amen. Now, a double to take an 11, or yes, an 11 pin lead. All right, Mike Edwards.
Game is a bust, they've always said, and he surely didn't trust that shot. Got a good break and has an easy spare. Conversion here, he'll trail Mike Edwards by 12.
All right, Chris Warren. You heard Mike's answer to the message for our troops in the Persian Gulf.
Yeah, I only have one thing to say to the boys over there, and just do your job, come home soon, come home safe. No one needs to be a hero.
All right. There's Chris Warren's yellow ribbon.
Got it tied around his waist there. He was rubbing a little bit of the dirt or oil. You can actually see it next to his index finger off the bowling ball. Heavily oiled lanes. You got to clean it off every time the ball comes back.
Leaving a 6-10.
Well, he just looks out of time. Very few times I've ever seen a top professional completely lose his timing. On that particular shot, he was just completely out of time, never gave him the ball enough room. Once again, gets a pretty good break, ending up with a 6-10 spare to shoot at, but he could be in real trouble, and Mike Edwards, his opponent, looks awfully tough.
That is deep trouble. Chopping the 6 off the 10. Chris Warren of Dallas.
Well, if you leave yourself enough tough spares, sooner or later something's going to go wrong. And Chris Warren had been getting by pretty lucky, and then all of a sudden he leaves the 6-10. Here you see it in the replay. The ball doesn't flatten out enough and chops the 6 straight off the 10. Wide open door, Mike Edwards, fifth frame.
Wasn't able to jump on the opportunity.
The 2-8-10, and Mike Edwards could have really put a nail in the coffin of Chris Warren with a strike there, but once again, he has a very tough shot. There's two schools of thought. My best thought, Chris, is to drive the 2-pin over into the 10 and then hope it bounces off to the 8. It's a very difficult shot hitting it straight on. That's not the way to do it, obviously.
All right, so it's an open frame, 95 through the 5th for Mike Edwards. His lead now is 10 pins. So Chris Warren is now in as deep as he was prior to that last frame.
Oh.
There's Chris looking away, as we indicated. Well, Mike is backstriking after a double before the open frame.
Well, Chris, he did something very important. Edwards getting both of those pins on a difficult split. And with a double up, it's two pins actually becomes one. Instead of having 93 in the fifth frame, he has 95. He's kept Chris Warren at bay, and he still leads by 10. Now, Warren needs to get some strikes together because he hasn't even been close.
Yes. There's the Masters champion, Chris Warren.
See the way Chris Warren attacks the right-hand lane. Not much of a slide on the approach. The big hook ball works this time. He's back in the match. One, a strike here in the seventh, it'd be all even.
And a two.
Move right.
Heard him say move right, and our bowling tip of the week deals with something like that. This week we start a series on how to adjust the lane conditions on the lane, and the PBA expert Lenny Nicholson helps us out. And once again we see the oil carrying down the lane, that heavy oil I described at the top carrying down the lane, making it more difficult to get the hook.
All right, we're in our very first match. Love bowling in this city, and they do a lot of it. There is Mike Edwards, and Mary Gagliano last September became Meg Edwards, Mike's wife. Pretty lady. Mike was hoping to take that 20-pin lead, but he's left the 9-pin. The winner will meet Walter Ray Williams, then David Ozio, and then Mike Miller. Just split through and through the pocket, and now this shot for a single pin. That spare was in the seventh. Let's hear from Bo Burton.
Chris Schenkel, a very difficult shot happened there for Mike Edwards, and once again, Walter Ray, we see the oil carrying down the lane. Do you have any special strategy as the hook ball continues not to work?
Well, it's working all right. It's just not working as well as it could be. But with the oil carry down, the people that hook the ball more can actually get around the oil carry down better than the guys who go straighter.
So you may have a little trouble, but good luck. Back to you, Chris.
And Mike Edwards, again, a single pin. Had a lot of single pin spares here today. The pressure is on, total of $175,000, 34 to the winner today. 263 professionals started this event. The Pro-Am was on Sunday. Competition spanning 56 games began on Monday. Mike Edwards continuing to lead here, now by 9 pins. This is our first match. Winner to meet the man Bo just talked to, Walter Ray Williams, then David Ozio, and then the tournament leader, Mike Miller.
You see the footwork of Chris Warren. 5-step delivery, doesn't use much of the approach. He's only 5 feet tall.
Disbelief.
A very difficult split. He has the 3-4-6-7-10 split, not very often seen, and he has to make this to really stay in the match. It's not that tough. All he has to do is get the ball over in the 3-6 zone, drive the 3-pin into the 4. The 4 will take out the 7. The ball will take out the 6 and 10. Let's see what happens. Very important shot. He needs it to stay in the match.
Gotta replay that one.
Super shot. He needs it to stay in the match. Eighth frame. Takes out the 4-7, the 3-6.
Oh, if that doesn't get it flowing, nothing will.
Puts himself in position, Chris, to be right back in the match. He trails by 14 pins, ninth frame. It's not over yet.
Come on.
Big trouble. This one's a lot tougher. Now, there's two schools of thought. You can either start the ball over here in the 6-10 zone and drive it over into the 4-pin. I believe, Chris, the best way to go is to get the ball over in the 4-7 zone where the 2 pins are and drive the 4 into the 6, 9, and 10. Let's see which way Chris Warren goes. He's going to try to go across lane. It's easy to get 4 pins this way, but it's more difficult to make it all, and he needs them all.
Well, you thought you had problems in league play last week. Chris wearing a microphone, he was speechless, and that's unusual for him. A 6-pin now for Mike Edwards, who Meg is tense.
Well, Chris, we're seeing something we've seen the last 3 years at the Showboat. Last year, this was the lowest scoring championship round of the season, the only one the players averaged under 200. And basically, we're seeing the same thing. The oil's carrying down the back end. There's just not much of a shot out there.
Mike is one of the two non-winners in our field of five, the other three having a total of 15 championships. For the next stop where he defends his title.
Pinole Valley. That's still going to be enough for a winner for Mike Edwards. The worst he can do is 177. He's got a makeable split here, the 3-9-10. Has to get the ball to the right side of the 3-pin, let the ball carry into the 9, and then the ball deflect over into the 10. It's a very interesting shot, and he really doesn't need it to win. He's going on to meet Walter Ray Williams Jr. in the second match.
All right, we have a winner. We'll have the final scores. ABC Sports presentation of the Professional Bowlers Tour will return after this message and a word from our ABC station.
The warm-up shots being taken, 56-game format this week. Normally the Pros Bowl 42 games, it's 56 games. Walter Ray Williams Jr., the higher finisher after 56 games, finishing third. He has the choice of either starting the match or finishing the match, and so he has opted to start second and let Mike Edwards start off the match. Edwards just snuck by the first match against a very confused Chris Warren. Let's see if he gets straightened out in the second match.
And here in his very first shot, leaving the 2-4-8, most of the bucket on the left lane.
Once again, I'll reiterate, the last 3 years in this championship pair, we've seen the lanes in pretty good shape as they warmed up. The big hook ball coming and working very well, then all of a sudden it doesn't work. And so they're having a lot of spares not coming up to the head pin as Mike Miller has left the 2-4-8.
Would you believe that?
Well, Chris, I'll believe anything. The championship pair, and I do remember bowling on this a couple of times in the early 80s, gets very, very difficult in this bowling center. I don't know if it's because they put so much oil on the lanes, that's what Walter Ray said, or because of the low humidity in this building or whatever it is, but they come very difficult, and they favor a guy like Walter Ray with a straight shot.
Walter Ray Williams, 5 championships. To his credit, 1986, he was the PBA Player of the Year. His style.
Walter Ray, with just a lot of natural ability, 5-step delivery, has a much better arm swing this year than I've seen in past years. He's keeping that ball inside out most all the way down. He kind of likes this shot. He says, boy, that ball should have hooked in there. But once again, the oil is carrying all the way down to the back end. There's no hook area. Very difficult shot.
Oh, and here we have another chop.
Going back, 1988, Chris, we sat here and watched Amleto Monacelli win this tournament with basically throwing a complete straight ball. He changed from his big hook style, as you see Walter Ray's balls hooking by the two pin and leaving the eight, changed from his big hook style through a straight shot, and that's the only way he could win. In fact, in one match, there was only three strikes rolled in the match. Monticelli rolled two, and his opponent just one. So I think the ideal thing to do here is straighten the shot out.
And Walter Ray thinks like you think. Walter Ray getting his strike, and it's unusual to have both professionals opening up in the very, very first frame.
Mike Edwards doing a little doctoring his bowling ball, putting a piece of white tape in there where his thumb had gone down, and now it needs it a little tighter.
Mike Edwards, he was shooting in the second frame with an open in the first. He's left the seven pin a little bit to the right of center now for this shot. And if you just joined us, it was Mike Edwards who eliminated Chris Warren, 190 to 161. Chris Warren leaving and heading up north, California Pinole. As the defending champion, picked up $6,000.
Edwards thinking of a way to overcome this championship pair. Historically, anybody who could find a real good shot has just breezed to the title. Last year, though, David Husted and Marshall Holman went to extra frames, won it in overtime. Husted.
And Mike leaving the 10 pin on the left lane.
When that oil gets down to the back end, you don't, not only when the ball comes back to the pocket, it doesn't hit as hard, just like there. As Meg, I don't think she understands what her husband's going through right now. Mike Edwards just trying to be, fill the frames. You don't need to get a lot of strikes when the score is low. Fill the frames, put the pressure on your opponent.
Walter Ray Williams wears his yellow ribbon, loops on his back. His trouser belt line. There you see it. Almost.
Walter trying to make an adjustment. He came in light, left the 2-8 in the first frame, so he moves his feet over a couple of boards and tries to go more directly towards the pocket. It drifts a little high for the 4-pin. Not much margin of error there. Walter Ray has made the proper move, though, and he'll stay close in the match.
And it goes right by.
Surprising, the player that was picked the best spare shooter on the professional bowlers tour by his peers, an honor he shares with Joe Berardi, completely misses two spares right out of the go, very uncharacteristic of Walter Ray Williams Jr.
And he's embarrassed.
And behind by 11.
Bowling with a vengeance to try to overcome what happened before, but it's a 10 pin.
Once again, Walter with a lower surface friction bowling ball. Trying to make it slide across the lane, a little more control.
Walter Ray Williams, his last win was in 1987, and match in the first game he had five. Okay, Bo.
Thank you, Chris. David Ozio, everybody seemed to be struggling out there. The big hook ball is just not working like it did all week long. What's your game plan?
Well, it seems like the lanes are probably tightened up a little bit more on the outside. Most of the week I played between first arrow and the second arrow and had a little bit of area to go down the lane with, and hopefully that's what's building right now. If I can manage to fall into that and set the ball up down the lane where I want it, hopefully some good scores will come out.
Well, he's going to try to go a little bit straighter, Chris. We'll see how he does in the semifinal.
And Mike Edwards bending one into the 1-3 pocket, leaving the 10 pin on the left lane. The defending champion here, David Husted, finished 52nd and picked up a check for $900. Okay, Mike now trying to mark with a spare. Ah! As Mike comes back, Walter Ray Williams is quickly up. Walter Ray, on our telecast last week, finished second to David Ozio, to whom Bo just talked.
Two of the finest players today, Walter Ray and Ozio. Mike Edwards doesn't take a backseat to anybody, though.
Very nice. And here, this college graduate, Walter Ray, had this to say in a message to our troops.
Well, I just hope what they're doing is getting peace done as soon as possible and they all come home safe.
Okay. Four-time World Horseshoe Pitching Champion. Three times World Junior Champion. That's a ringer.
That's for sure. That was a sweet shot. His best shot, most aggressive, most confident shot as he cuts the leads of Mike Edwards down to one pin. And I believe that Walter Ray Williams Jr., as you see his style and his reaction, has the best idea. When the lanes will not accommodate the big hook ball, go hard and straight. It's match play competition.
Mike again with a single pin spare.
There's an old saying in bowling, the conditions determine the player. And the type of lane condition that's out there right now favors a straighter type of player. And over the 56-game format, most of the power players rise to the top on the PBA Tour because of their strike power and crossing lanes. But in the championship round, the down-and-in player often has the advantage.
Close. Next week, Chris Warren defends his title as the world's top bowlers roll into Northern California for the $130,000 ARC Pinole Open. Coverage begins at a special time of 12 Eastern and Pacific, 11 Central, next Saturday, ABC's Pro Bowlers Tour.
Jess barely clips the 10 pin off as he gets a good break, and the match is all even right now.
There was some extraneous noise from the spectators here. Thus the stop and restart.
The 4-9 split, Chris. Remember him losing the Quaker State Open to Mike Durbin with that exact same shot. He needed a strike to win the tournament, left a 4-9. Once again, it's a tied match, and he leaves a 4-9 split. He has to get the ball over here, slide the 4 into the 9 to make it. Here's how it's done. If he makes this, he'll trail by 2 pins. If he doesn't, he drops 13 behind.
Going all out, courageous bowler that he is. Mike Edwards dropping behind now.
One strike in the fourth frame. Meg Edwards is saying, boy, that isn't the way it looks in practice. But, Meg, that isn't the way the lanes are in practice. This is a very difficult lane condition. The match is not over. Right now, Edwards has a potential 193. Williams going at a 196 pace.
All right. Crazy game, Bo. Like Chris Warren, who was eliminated by Mike. In the first match, he had two big games to make the number five position last night. But today, he could only shoot a 161.
Well, Warren averaged right at 200 for the whole week and then almost 240 at night. So this is like a morning lane condition. So he really was programmed to strike struggle at night. Now, you watch Mike Edwards. He's standing way over here. He's going to slide here and have a ball trajectory right between the first and second arrows.
Right, Mike.
And really, the same thing's happening to Mike Edwards. Is he averaged only 205 in this championship pair for the four games out of the 56 he bowled in the tournament. And he was kind of figured to be struggling, where Walter Ray Williams Jr. averaged 224 on this pair all week, so he should be a slight favorite.
Our tournament leader, Mike Miller, averaged 250. Now, a look at Walter Ray Williams. Mike looking overhead score sheet.
Walter Ray leading by 24, needs good counts and a mark in one of the last two frames to lock up the match.
Porter Ray from Stockton, California, grew up in Eureka.
One of seven children who all enjoy bowling and horseshoes. Now we'll see how Walter Ray's attacking the lane. He has this match well under control. Walter Ray, once again, he'll start over here in the right-hand corner. A slight drift, not nearly as much as Mike Edwards, but he'll play a much straighter shot right around the first arrow. You won't see the big hook. That's enough to win the match, Chris. The solid nine is disappointing, but even if he misses that spare, he'll end up with 184.
He's going against, of course, Mike Edwards, who's proud of his Choctaw and Cherokee heritage. Walter Ray, the physics major at college. And he has won, and now he has a chance to go against the man that cost him a tournament last week, Ozio. Nelson Burton Jr.'s playing conditions and what to do about them.
Score more. Help you solve your bowling problems.
Here's what the pros do.
Learn Bo's valuable tips on performance, practice techniques, body conditioning, and equipment selection, and score more. Only $24.98 plus $3 shipping. To order Bo's home video, call 1-800-4-ABC-BCR.
It was Mike Edwards who defeated Chris Warren 190 to 161 in the first match. Then in stepped Walter Ray Williams with a 156 score and only one strike by Mike Edwards. He is out, and Walter Ray Williams, as a result, moves one up against David Ozio, who beat him last week.
Chris, a very long tournament there this week, 56 games, and we have a strong field here. And you see next week we're at the Panola Open, and we're on at 12 Eastern. Look at that time. And then down to the Quaker State Open, where Randy Peterson will defend his title. In the big field of 263 players, 200 average for the whole field, not too bad. 213 to make the top 24, and here's how some of the other players finished. Alexander and Wiseman pick up some pretty good checks. Jazz Now, Jim Johnson, Steel Smith, coming back a little bit. Newman, Granger was the early leader. Steve Wunderlich 2 weeks in a row. Randy Peterson, Quaker State, defending his title. Albert, Columbia, the U.S. Open champion. Smooth Dave Arnold. Groth, right up in there. Ken Johnson, Scroggins. Ricky Corona. Lawrence, we've seen him a lot of times in 1990. And Brad Snell round out the top 24, Chris.
All right, and Walter Ray Williams will shoot first. There he is on the left lane. Had five strikes in his victory over Mike Edwards. Seven pin. For the man that in his career has had 11 second place finishes. In fact, he has made 18 telecasts since winning a PBA tournament.
You know, he's a good winner. That's such a surprising stat. So it's been over 3 years, so this will be a key game right here for him.
So now David Ozio, who came to the fore last week. He's 3-1 from the top seed. He won from there last week. Now he is the second seed today. All right, like where he left off last week.
David Ozio, just a classic style. Five-step delivery, good push away, shoulder-high swing, wrist-cupped, deep knee bend, excellent follow-through, and so well-practiced. He and Steve Wunderlich have to be the best practicers on the tour. I mean, they practice and practice. He probably practiced over 100 games every week, even when he's off.
I'll tell you, he and Steve are good. These lanes as well, they won the doubles here at Showboat last year.
Very smooth shot right there by David, and yet the 10-pin doesn't go as he changes balls for the spare.
Here's a man that would like to win consecutive championships. Dick Weber did it. So did Don Johnson. First two of the year, that is. Using all of the approach, a little more. Another 10 pin.
Well, Walter just being around the pocket, he's not going to beat himself that way. I don't see for any way it's going to take a big score to win this match. So Walter, as you see from the overhead, Nice snap of the ball, snap of his head, but once again he doesn't snap out the 10. Well, the man who was voted the best spare shooter on a professional bowlers tour is quickly giving that title away. He co-holds that title with Berardi, who Joseph didn't make the top five this week, so he can't miss any out here. He has missed two spares in the first game and one in the second.
Hard That's to believe.
Not good.
All right, now David Ozio. Open with a strike if you just joined us. We're in our third game, spare up, shooting in the third frame. Okay, David Ozio had this message for our troops in the Gulf.
Well, I've followed this very closely the last few days, and I am totally awed at the amazing courage and of the president, both, and you guys. Watch your backsides and come home safely. Your families love you and they need you there. God bless you.
What sincerity.
So much so. Right now, he'd like to finesse this ball down in the pocket and take a 22-pin lead over the man he defeated last week for the AC Delco title, Walter Ray Williams, Jr.
All right, David Ozio, doubling and going out to a 22-pin lead over Walter Ray Williams, Jr. We'll be back. High hit, leaving the 3-6-10. With a strike there, he would have come back to within 12 pins of his opponent, David Ozio. Wastes no time, this man. And just get it, that ball just keeps going to the right. And we go to our right to Bo Burton.
Thank you, Chris Schenkel. Mike Miller, tournament leader. Unique style, Mike. No thumb in the ball. Let's see how it works. Mike just sets it all the way on the wrist. There's not even a thumb hole in the ball, and Mike, you're going to have a little problem maybe this last game. The lanes look very tough. Have you tried this style with a lot of carry down on the lane?
I've tried it only a couple of times because I've only been 10 tournaments now. So I've got a couple of different balls drilled up, and we'll just see what happens. I think I'm confident.
One second question. You can throw it straight with your thumb in the ball. You ever consider going back to that?
I did one game this week, but that was on a real radical pair. I don't think I'll be doing that right now, though.
All right, his first title shot, Chris. Let's see what happens in the final match.
And Walter Ray has to be content with more spares and strikes today, having five in his victory in the previous game over Mike Edwards. So David Ozio faring a little bit better. David's yellow ribbon, left hip pocket. Coming up high, leaving the 6-10. Be fun to see the tournament leader, Mike Miller, performing.
Well, it's so interesting, and he does it so well. It's just about the maximum power you can get on a bowling ball. So it could be the wave of the future. I asked a lot of the players their opinion of it, and they're kind of mixed.
Okay. So they've been doing that. Each of the bowlers that have come through here has done just that.
You know, once again, the old question comes up, should you change balls for spares? And we've seen players out there changing balls for spares today. They either drop it, make some mistake, and his three top players have had problems with easy spares today. So I'm not sold on changing balls for spares. Change the shot every once in a while.
All right, get breaks like that one. David Ozio gives a long look down there, 60 feet. We're in our semifinal match. Watch again.
The two pin, the third pin on the left-hand part of your screen. That's the key pin. Head pin, hits the two, drives it between the four and seven pins. David Ozio has a strike in the six. Walter up in the six, trails by nine.
All right. That was more like Walter Ray Williams, Jr. There he is, Harry Golden, tournament director, just retired after 29 years working with us. We are so proud of this man. Knowing him all these years, Bo, has been one of the features of my enjoyment of you professional bowlers and the tour.
Agreed. More than 200 people at his party this week. A lot of friends flew in from all over the country.
And our producer, Carol Letty, and director, Larry Cam, and all ABC, presented him with a chair. And I might add, there were no rockers on it. We'll be back.
Get away from it all in the new Explorer from Ford. If you're looking for four doors and more interior room than any vehicle in its class, if you want four-liter power and push-button four-wheel drive in the best-selling vehicle in its class, if the only thing you want to leave behind is the city, your Explorer is ready.
Your Super Bowl weekend with some Super Bowlers. The game's best. Head to Northern California for the ERC Pinole Open on ABC's Pro Bowlers Tour next Saturday.
It was another great year for Amleto Monicelli. $204,000 on the lanes. Back-to-back PBA Player of the Year honors. Chris Warren second, Bone Palumbi. And some great names there in that top five.
And they'll be back all this year, 1991. A little note, Amleto Monicelli has not bowled the first 2 weeks. He's afraid of air terrorism and has not flown from Venezuela. He's going to wait till this conflict, or at least flying, is a little safer. So he's not on the tour.
All right. David Ozio with that double gets himself up by 9 pins, a big, big shot. Another one coming up here.
Want to see the really great styles in today's game? Let's take a look at how David Ozio attacks the lane. We'll watch his standing position, his starting position, how perfectly he walks the approach. Almost in the center, he'll slide in this area, just play a medium hook right inside the first arrow. Nothing real big, nothing fancy, but look at how perfect this approach is.
It's like that pin had brakes on it.
That's the head pin shooting across. That would have given Walter Ray, David Ozio, a nice lead, but not to be. And so right now the lead is down to just 8 pins for Ozio, if he can make the spare. But once again, remember, he went by a spare on the right-hand lane when he's changed balls for the spare. Let's see if he can make this to maintain the lead.
Pins separating these two professionals, and what a big pivotal game it is. It's a semifinal game. The winner goes in against non-winner tournament leader Mike Miller. These two were in the final match last week, Ozio defeating Walter Ray. That's three in a row for Walter Ray.
Walter Ray really attacks. He leaned on his Sunday shot. He knew that was like the 10th frame. He puts everything he's got in him. You see the grimace in his face. And for the first time in 2 weeks, Walter Ray Williams Jr. has a lead over David Ozio. Let's see if he can put the pressure on him here with a fourth consecutive strike in the 9th frame.
And he does. You know, Bo, often, any kind of stress or pressure situation, I've heard the adage, when in trouble, when the pressure is there, slow down. And Dave has been known to do that, and the pressure's on right now.
He has to. He's a very disciplined player, obviously very confident at this point, but he needs strikes right now in the 9th and 10th frames on a very tough main condition.
Oh, yeah. He breaks and keeping this match very, very close, and it is a big one. Of course, this is a big place, Showboat, as we get a replay.
The powerful ball of David Ozio almost leaves a solid 9. Pin comes across, knocks it out, and for David Ozio to win this match and put some pressure on Williams, he must strike here in the 10th. He trails by 12, can cut it to 2.
Mm-hmm. Tremendous professionals. Between them, 12 PBA titles. David is 36. Walter Ray is 31. Just coming into their prime, showing why they've won those hard-to-earn PBA titles.
And Ozio looks better than ever. Last week he was dominant winning the tournament. Right now he has already forced Williams to mark in the 10th. With a strike here, he'll force Williams to strike in the 10th.
He got up there so calm and collected. Easy. Follow through, Bo. What a pressure player.
Excellent. Shows a lot of confidence, a lot of experience, and he must have been listening to you, Chris. He kept those feet nice and slow, finessed the ball in the pocket under pressure. Look at this form. You don't see any jerks. You see that head smooth, the eyes solid on the target. Right now he's a potential 225. If he gets more than 8 pins, he will force Walter Ray Williams to strike twice. All right, 224 for Ozio. Walter Ray Williams Jr. has to strike in the 10th and 11th frames. Win the match. The first one is a must.
Sliding by, leaving the 2-8.
He can't do it now. The best he can do is 215. Walter Ray Williams Jr. once again is thwarted in his bid to end the 19 consecutive telecasts without a win. And once again, 2 weeks in a row, he goes down to defeat to Ozio. Scores in material. Best he can do is 215.
Okay, that was our semifinal match. Ozio moves into the finals against Miller's ABC Sports presentation of the Professional Bowlers Tour. We'll return after this message and a word from our ABC station.
We have permission to die.
Danny Glover.
It's all we really got.
Okay, Mike Edwards winning the first match here as we summarize over Chris Warren, 190-161. Scoring was also a problem in our second match of the afternoon. As you can see, Mike embarrassed with his 156, Walter Ray's 195. Walter Ray then moved into the man that defeated him last week, David Ozio. And Walter Ray is out, 224 to 215. So it is a non-winner, Miller, going against Ozio here at the Showboat Plains in Las Vegas, Nevada, where we've televised for the past 30 consecutive seasons. It's a hotel and casino, and it's a very relaxed place. Everybody has a good time, and here we have Mike Miller stepping in. And Bo, the handshake, and Mike can relax a little while this man will have to shoot first.
Ozio up first, championship game. Miller has never been in that position. Ozio going for two titles in a row to open the 1991 season.
Wow, what balance of that pin.
Well, actually what happens, he rips that five out, and what happens, the pin comes over and stands it back up. Now that pin shall stay off spot as long as it's not knocked over by the machine. So it's slightly off spot, so you can call it the five and a half pin right now. Ozio should have no trouble making this shot.
Okay. So now, stepping in, Mike Miller. Tournament leader hit the grip.
Mike Miller, no thumb hole in the ball, Chris. Watch where he sets his hand. Semi-fingertip grip. He only puts his fingers in between the first and second knuckles, wraps it back on his wrist, and it's the most powerful bowling ball you could possibly throw.
Welcome to ABC Sports coverage of the Professional Bowlers Tour.
In his first shot in a championship round, it's going to be very difficult for Mike because when the oil carries down, as anybody's watched this whole championship round, it's very difficult to control the big hook or even make it hook that much. So Mike, who now puts his thumb in the ball to shoot spares, has a very tough shot.
All right, leaving a 6-10. And an open frame for the 29-year-old who bowls out of Albuquerque, New Mexico.
I've seen other kids around the country when I've been practicing or doing exhibitions rolling this type of shot, but Mike Miller knew how to bowl. He was an established, pretty good pro out here on the tour. And you add this power to that experience, he's going to be somebody to contend with.
Okay, man that's rolled perfect 300 games in five of the last six tournaments.
Oh. Another 10-pin for Ozio. And I asked David Ozio, Chris, about the style of his opponent, Mike Miller. And here's some of the comments from Ozio. If it's a trend of the future, he sure it is. He says he remembers when Bob Benoit, who bowled 300 at the Quaker State a few years back, became a big cranker, a power player, and he got better. So he believes in at least Miller's style. A couple of things he's surprised about, Chris, is number one, that as much success that Miller has had, none of the other players are really practicing it out here. And I think, myself, if I saw a player having that much success, I'd be at least trying something.
Fidgeting is Miller.
Probably putting some tape in his finger hole.
Okay, Ozio back striking. Defeated Walter Ray Williams 224 to 215. Now up is Miller, who's sponsored by his family. Family of great bowling accomplishments. And with that style, he has cut the lead to one pin.
You said a family of great bowling styles, as you see the profile of Mike Miller. Look at that wrist cuffed right there. Look at that position. Bent elbow, then he just shovels right underneath it. No thumb in the ball, maximum power, and he has to keep his fingers under the ball to keep that type of control. He is just wonderful. I think it's really the wave of the future, Chris, and I think he's going to be like Roger Bannister did with the four-minute mile. He's going to make everybody step it up a level.
Said push-ups and hand exercises help build him up to make this style a success. Okay, Las Vegas, we'll take a break. We'll be back. Beautiful center in Las Vegas. Now David Ozio is ready to shoot here on the right lane with a strike up. Can take the lead right here.
David, something bothered him a little bit. Didn't look like anything extraneous from the audience or anything. Chris, it must have been his thumb just slipped in the ball. And once again, he's going to violate the 25-second rule, and it's going to be a $100 fine. If there's no extraneous interference, he's gone by the 25 seconds.
All right. Good that he took his time. Right? Taking a one-pin lead. So apparently was a disturbance in the audience, right?
Well, I sure didn't see it or hear it, and he sure didn't acknowledge it.
John Campos, our tournament director, who has moved in, is Harry Golden, whom we showed you earlier, is retired after 29 years. We wish Johnny a lot of luck. Good guy. So a three-bagger now puts Ozio, who won last week, into an 11-pin lead. But here now, with a three-bagger working, Mike Miller.
Boy, sure testing Miller. Miller came right back after that open frame in the first with three strikes in a row. And once again, he trails by 11, though, coming up the fifth frame against the very, very red-hot David Ozio.
All right. Mike with four in a row. Oh, he's impressive.
Well, he's so strong that he can overcome the lane condition that everybody else has fought all day long. The players have only averaged 190 for the first three games. So, once again, it's very, very powerful ball that's overcoming the lane condition. As you see Mike's father and his little daughter, Adrian.
Left a 10-pin on the left lane, our tournament leader. This is our second stop on the Professional Bowlers Tour when the championship game. It was Mike Miller, a non-winner, but is the tournament leader after 56 tough games. And right now going against David Ozio, who won last week. And Ozio, still with a two-pin lead, can up it to 12. He has a three-bagger working. Bingo's breaks now to pinfall. You just joined us. Mike Edwards defeated Chris Warren 190 to 161 in the first game. And Walter Ray Williams defeated Edwards 195 to 156. Ozio over Williams 224 to 215. And now we're just beyond the halfway point of the championship game, worth $34,000 to the winner and $18,000 to the runner-up. Make it five in a row. Okay.
The experience of Ozio coming through, he has a chance to really put the pressure on Miller, and he applies a 22-pin difference. Mike Miller, once again, does not bowl with a thumb hole in the bowling ball. Look, there is no thumb hole, no thumb in the ball. Maximum power. Let's see if he can come back.
That power. That ball crossed over.
Well, that's the drawback of not having your thumb in the ball. The thumb is basically there to take a little of the pressure off the wrist and control. And when he does lose it, as you see him putting his thumb in the ball, conventional style for spares because he doesn't need power, when he loses control, he gets very wild as he was on the first shot.
Okay. The 30th anniversary year of ABC's Wide World of Sports starts today. Great figure skaters from Barcelona, Spain, and the NutraSweet World Challenge of Champions. Brian Boitano, never better anytime, Bo.
Debbie Thomas looks good, and I know you called the action with Peggy Fleming.
Mm-hmm.
That's about 10 minutes from now.
Don't miss it. Not because Peggy and I did it, but because the greatest skaters in the world were on it, and it's a beautiful show from Barcelona.
And can't miss it is what you can say to Mike Miller right now is... He has a very simple spare of the two-pin, but he can't afford to miss this in the eighth frame to stay close in the match.
We've had nobody winning consecutive games here today.
Well, Ozio looks like he's well on his way to not only winning consecutive games, but consecutive mm-hmm. tournaments. He has all the experience. He has the years of out here of self-confidence. He bowled so super last week, and he looks just sensational today in... If I know David, this is the key shot to lock up the match.
It's been 19 years since the bowler has won the first two games of our telecasting season. That was Don Johnson. 10 years prior to that, Dick Weber did it. Well, he's getting a six-bagger a little more on the end of this week. Last week, he was strong up front.
You're right. He started last week with six in a row before leaving a spare. Had a potential 300 game last week. Started out with two spares and then has strung six in a row. And you could tell by his reaction how important that eighth frame was. Now this one slams the door. Strike here for Ozio. It's back-to-back titles.
Perfection of... ABC's Live World of Sports, shown right here by our professional bowler, in addition to the World Challenge of Champions. There have been some dramatic developments concerning World Cup downhill skiing in Wengen, Switzerland. During qualifying yesterday, a young Austrian skier had a terrible fall, and tragically, this morning. Consequently, the event scheduled for today has been suspended, but Bob Beatty in Europe will have a full report.
Now, Mike Miller comes up in the 10th frame, a possible 235. He will not win this match. Ozio, unless he fouled or threw it in the gutter, which I don't expect he'll do, has it locked up. But Mike Miller, watch his style. Remember that name, because you're going to see a lot more of this young man. He's tough. He's bowled very well today. He's just going up against a red-hot, experienced Ozio.
Hmm.
Mike has all his family here. His dad, Gary, bowls on the seniors tour, which we telecast last year from the doubles events from the showboat. There's father, Gary, daughter, Adrian. Gary, he knows the score. His son's in a little bit of trouble, but he should be very proud of him. And you're going to see a lot of this man. He really has it together.
Only 29 years old, 6'1", 180 pounds.
It's going to bowl 224, Chris, and I figured that would be enough to win the title, as tough as the lane conditions have been here all week long. But he's going against David Oden, red hot.
David Ozio, the big year last year, earning nearly $100,000. Overall, he's over $600,000.
Last week, it was $259 for the AC Delco Classic. He has a chance for $279. Back-to-back championships. Ozio just bowling with some confidence. And just fabulous scores. Just finessing that ball in the pocket.
Well, we've had a little bit of everything today. A 161, a 156. Biggest score up to this was by Ozio, 224. And he's going to have a big one right here. Miller shooting 224 in this final. So we'll be back at the Showboat following this.